this morning as we join our hearts together to worship. We're glad that you are here. Whether you have joined us on campus or online today, we welcome you to this time of worship. This week, we want to remember to pray for some of
our...
I'm so sorry. We welcome you this morning, whether you're online or on campus with us, to this time of worship. This is a time we gather with the people of God, and a part of what we do in gathering with the people of God is pray for the people of God. This morning, we want to remember Dorothy Rayford. Dorothy is hospitalized at UT Southwestern. She was taken by ambulance yesterday, and so you want to pray for Dorothy at this particular time. In addition to our prayer for Dorothy, we rejoice. We have been praying for Miguel and Orquídea Chong, Ruiz Chong. They have accepted a new position, a job in California, and so they have been traveling this week, driving from here to California, and so we have been praying for them. And now it is our opportunity to celebrate. They've arrived safely. We grieve the loss of them as part of our family of faith. They will be uniting with the congregation in Fontana, California. And so we have been praying with Miguel about a new position, a job that would really satisfy the desire of his heart. And so we're excited about what God has done to answer that prayer. At the same time, you understand that we grieve the loss of those to our congregation.
It sounds this morning like I've got a problem with my microphone, so let's just take it a different way this morning. Let me share with you from Psalm chapter 68 this morning some words from God's Word that will actually be a part of our message today. Out of the book of Ephesians, there is a quotation that comes from this book. We will read, though, a particular section of Psalm 68 this morning. Listen to these words from God's Word. Blessed be the Lord who daily bears our burdens, the God who is our salvation. God is to us a God of deliverance. God is to us a God of deliverances. And to God the Lord belongs escapes from death. Surely God will shatter the head of his enemies, the hairy crown of him who goes on in his guilty deeds. The Lord said, I will bring them back from Bashan. I will bring them back from the depths of the sea, that your foot may shatter them in blood, the tongue of your dogs may have its portion from your enemies. They have seen your procession, O God, the procession of God my King into the sanctuary. The singers went on, the musicians after them, the midst of the maidens beating tambourines. Bless God in the congregations, even the Lord, you who are the fountain of Israel. There is Benjamin, the youngest, ruling them. The princes of Judah in their throng, the princes of Zebulun and the princes of Naphtali. Your God has commanded your strength. Let me say that again. Your God has commanded your strength. Show yourself strong, O God, who have acted on our behalf. Because of your temple in Jerusalem, kings will bring gifts to you. Rebuke the beasts in the reeds, the herds of bulls with the calves of the peoples, trampling underfoot the pieces of silver. He has scattered the peoples who delight in war. Envoys will come out of Egypt. Ethiopia will quickly stretch out her hands to God. So, sing praises. Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord, to him who rides upon the highest heavens, which are from ancient times. Behold, he speaks forth with his voice, a mighty voice. Ascribe strength to God. His majesty is over Israel, and his strength is in the skies. O God, you are awesome from your sanctuary. The God of Israel himself gives strength and power to the people. Blessed be God. I want you to understand this morning, as we come to the book of Ephesians, we are viewing redemption from heaven's perspective, from a heavenly perspective. We look at the very throne room of God,
and we experience how high and lifted up and massively marvelous is our God. And we ascribe to Him our praise. And so we come now to sing to Him songs that lift His name, that in the midst of our hearts and the hearts of those online says our God is an incomparable God, a unique God, the only God. And we worship Him. We pray this morning as well for Vicky. As she is not with us this morning, we just rejoice in her being a part of our praise team and God's being with her this week as she's spent some time in some tests this week. So would you with me now just pray and let's thank God for His presence among us, our exalted reigning God. Father, this morning so many of our people, so many of our members are experiencing things that they would really prefer not to have to go through. Some are hospitalized. Some have spouses, loved ones who are so debilitated right now that, Father, it just seems as there is no quality of life anymore. Some have loved ones who are hurting today. Some have those who have been through this week the experience of test and treatment. But Father, in all these things, we hear the apostle say that we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us, that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And we ascribe to that. We agree with that. We exalt You today. And we say You alone are God of gods and Lord of lords. There is no God like You. There is no God above You. And there is no God except You. Today, would You allow us to come and visit the very throne of room of God? We understand that You have invited us there in prayer that we might experience grace to help in time of need. We pray today, Father, for Dorothy Rayford. We lift her to You and ask You, Father, intervene in her very being right now. Meet her deepest need. Be with those in the medical profession who are tending to her today, but You be great physician to her. We thank You today that You were with Miguel and Arcadia, with Miguelito and Monet as they drove this week from here in Mesquite all the way to Fontana, California. A long trip, carrying their belongings, pulling their car behind them. We thank You for being with them. We grieve the loss of them to our congregation, to our family of faith. We pray that rapidly You will connect them with a family of faith where they can grow as followers of Jesus in Fontana. Now today, we thank You for every person who is here. We thank You for every soul who is gathered with us online. And we pray that in the midst of these moments, the power of God's Spirit will pour over us. That we experience Your presence and You experience the praise of Your people as we lift our hearts to You, as we worship You, as we claim that there is no other God and that You are our God, our Lord, our Savior, our mighty provider, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's just praise the Lord this morning. Promises of God.
Here I am to worship.
you for the time of worship, for leading us to say, I was made to worship you. That is really our testimony, isn't it? We were created to worship, to have fellowship, to be in this relationship with a God who loves us. I invite you this morning to turn with me to the book of Ephesians again, as we are involved in our study of Ephesians. Last week, we launched into this study looking at the major themes of this book that has been referred to as the most contemporary book in all of the Bible. Of course, we haven't gotten past the first two verses yet, but I want you to jump with me today to Ephesians chapter 4. Because before we move further into our study of Ephesians, moving through next week, we're going to look at what we in our front porch have referred to as seven rocket verbs that the Apostle Paul gives in that run-on sentence that begins in the third verse of Ephesians chapter 1 and goes all the way down through the 14th verse. So we're going to next week look at seven rocket verbs. But today, we turn all the way over to the fourth chapter, and you'd say, well, Pastor, if we're going to study the book of Ephesians, why don't we just go through it? Because I want you to know what Paul is doing in this book of Ephesians. I want you to know what the nature of his thought pattern is, his thought process is. And as is often the case in the Apostle Paul's writing, he initially starts out with a section that focuses on God and who he is and the realities that we experience about our God. It's a doctrinal section, if you will. And then at the midway point in many of his letters, he will transition from what we know of God to what difference that makes in our daily lives. He will often introduce that by saying, I beseech you therefore. And that's exactly what he does in Ephesians chapter 4. And so today I want us to see what I have referred to as the pivot point in the book of Ephesians. The pivot point in the book of Ephesians. And it is found in Ephesians 4 chapter 1. We're going to actually read verses 1 through 16 of Ephesians chapter 4, just so that you have the entire context. But I'm going to encourage you, even as we read, if you've got your Bible, I want you to mark verses 1, and then verses 7 and 8, and then verse 12, so that you see these critical components of this little section of Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. The Word of God says this in Ephesians chapter 4, and you see it on screen with us. Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another, in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, and one Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. Now this expression, he ascended, what does it mean except that he also had descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is himself also he who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. And he gave some as apostles and some as prophets and some as evangelists and some as pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of service to the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. As a result, we are no longer to be children tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in all aspects into Him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Father, would you open our hearts now in just brief moments to encounter you? You have invited us already into this book of Ephesians to view this marvelous work of redemption, the salvation that has been wrought for us through Jesus Christ our Lord, not from earth's perspective, but from heaven's perspective. This book is not written as a corrective to doctrinal error, to wrong belief, or to correct behavior that is wrong in the church. It's not about bad belief or bad behavior or bad manners. It's about looking at redemption from a heavenly perspective. You've invited us into the very throne room of God, so that we may see your plan, your purpose, what you are working out through Christ and in us. Now today, Father, would you help us to comprehend the application of this redemption, this resurrection that was accomplished in Christ, and when he was resurrected, we were resurrected, raised up together with him, and made to sit with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Positionally, we are with him today in heaven. And yet we live our lives here. We live our lives here as a testimony, as a harbinger to a lost world, as a demonstration plot of what the kingdom of God truly looks like in a damned and doomed world apart from Jesus. So teach us today, Spirit of God. Give us insights beyond our own capacity, for in our own mind we would not comprehend, but with the mind of Christ we may understand what you would say to us. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me read again three or four verses. You mark them. The first verse, therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. Verse 8, therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. Verse 12, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ. Those are the key verses of this section. It's the pivot point of this book of Ephesians. And it begins by our understanding our call, the call. He says that there in the first verse, therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner of the calling, worthy of the calling with which you have been called. This word called is the word kaleo. We are called into relationship. You have done calisthenics in the past. It's an action that results in giving strength, making you beautiful. That's the nature of this word, kaleo. It's the call to something that makes beautiful. And I want you to understand, the voice is the one who calls. I want you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. You and I didn't call ourselves. We were called into relationship with God through Jesus Christ our Lord. He is the one who does the calling. He is the voice. And he calls. This word call is what happened to Adam there in the garden. Remember, he was created for relationship with God. And God in the afternoon came and walked in the garden and said, Adam, where are you? This is the same God whose voice was to Abraham, saying to him, get up and leave the land in which you're born and go to the land that I will show you. And he would become the father of the people of God. This is the same voice that spoke to Moses out of a burning bush, remember, and said, Moses, Moses. And Moses responded, who are you? And God said, I am that I am. Moses heard the voice, and the voice revealed his own name to Moses. This is the voice of Jesus to his disciples as he passed by them in their several places of work and said to them, "Follow me." And they left what they had and followed him. It is the voice of Saul on the way to Damascus when he was going to persecute the church and instead was encountered by the voice of Jesus Christ, who said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you? I am Jesus whom you are persecuting." Friends, the whole counsel of the Word of God is the counsel of one who is revealing himself, who is the voice that is speaking to us. The very nature of the Hebrew word for Bible comes from the word for voice, or spoken, or called. Don't look at the Word of God and see it as a book to be studied, but rather hear it as the Word from the Father revealing himself, a voice to be heard. We were called by God. What does it mean to be called? Well, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 says that you and I were dead in our trespasses and sins, that our sin had separated us from God, and that we were completely separated from Him, and that we were dead in our trespasses. It also says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12, that we were without hope in the world, that if we have sinned and come short of the glory of God, that in and of ourselves we can do nothing to stir up hope. We are hopeless unless somebody external to us does something to bring us back into relationship. We were hopeless until Jesus. It goes on to say that in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8, that we are light. Something has transformed us from this darkness that we were, lost, separated from God, dead, hopeless, to the point that we are light in a marvelous way, light in the midst of darkness, as Peter says in 1 Peter 2:9. We were called out of darkness into His marvelous light. That's what our calling is. It is a calling from what we were to what God wants us to be. It is a calling from when we were hopeless to the point that we are filled with hope and confidence in the goodness of God who has saved us and will hold on to us and keep us until the day of His appearing. It is our hope, this calling. And therefore, we are to be careful how we walk. I want you to understand the call of God. Before COVID began, we had the privilege of leading to faith in Christ Benny Valadez. Benny came to know Jesus as his Lord and Savior, and he was baptized in the baptistry as a testimony to everybody of a transformed life. And when he is raised up out of the water, do you remember what we said? And raised to walk in newness of life in Christ Jesus, the call beckons us into a future that has never been experienced before. It's a new thing. It's a promise. It's a new creation. It's resurrection from the dead. When Jesus resurrected, you were resurrected with Him. That is the reality of the call, folks. It's not just some same old, same old. Nobody else has ever experienced the call that you personally have experienced into relationship with Jesus Christ and what He wants to do in and through you. That's the nature of the call, this kaleo to God. He says, "Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called." So we've looked at the call. Let's look at the walk. The walk is second. That word is parapateo. It's the word from which we get a peripatetic teacher, one who walks around teaching. This is our response to the voice. It's a life of worship. Once we have experienced the call of God, then we respond to that call of God with a life lived in relationship with Him. Our walk, our peripateo, this daily life we live, what we do day in and day out, is informed by our call into relationship with Jesus. Now you need to understand this. One person said it this way: our credenda becomes our agenda. Now, we don't use the word credenda. You do use the word agenda. It's what is on your daily list of activities. We don't use the word credenda, but we do use the word credenza. Huh? What is a credenza? Well, a credenza was originally a piece of furniture that they set the food out on so that the food taster could come and taste the food to make sure it wasn't poisonous. So the food taster tastes the food, and if he doesn't die, then you eat it. It's true. It's proven. It's good. That's the nature of credenza. We say it gives credence to. It makes it believable. Well, when the food tester ate the food and lived, it gave credence to the fact. It made you believe that the food was good. What you believe informs how you live. That's the nature of what this is saying. It is always true that the foliage and the fruit are related to the root. Where your roots go down is going to have a significant influence on what grows up in your life. You walk out of who you have been be created to be in Christ Jesus in response to the call. When he lived, that food taster, you could believe that it was safe to eat. It gave credence to the possibility that it was really okay. What you believe influences how you live on a daily basis. The walk is how we live. God calls, we walk. God calls, we walk. That's the nature of the relationship. God calls and we obey. We walk. We sing sometimes, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be faithful in Jesus but to trust and obey. He speaks, we respond. He calls, we walk. Now I don't want you to miss this. Now look at what we have left out of that first verse so far. Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk, how? In a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. One more time. I implore you to walk, how? In a manner worthy of the call to which you have been called. Now, this is the pivot point. This is the pivot point. So we've looked at the call and the walk. Now we're at the pivot. It is this little word in the original language that is axios. Look at this thing on screen right now. See that right there? Mom had one of those. I don't know if it's somewhere in her stuff that we have or not. On the left-hand side there, as you look at that, there are weights. There are different weights. You can stack them on top of each other, or you can put just 1 pound on there if you want to. And then that bowl on the right-hand side, then you get chocolate-covered peanuts. You put 1 pound on the left, and you put chocolate-covered peanuts in that bowl on the right-hand side until what happens? Until it balances. And the moment it balances, that is axios. That is a manner worthy of walking related to the call. Now, I want you to see that image, and I want you to do this. On one side, the apostle says, is your what? Your calling. And he wants what is on the left-hand side, your calling, to be balanced out, to be worthy of what is on the other side. One side has to balance out the other. Now, you see there on the left-hand side where it has all those weights standing there right now? In your mind, I want you to do something with me. I want you to remove every one of those weights. And I want you to put there everything that you know about the holy, righteous, loving, gracious God who is creator, sustainer of all that exists. I want you to go to heaven for just a moment, and I want you to experience all that God is. I want you to think of everything that Jesus Christ has done for us, where he left the throne of glory and came in fashion as a man and gave his life by paying our sin debt through his own death on the cross. I want you to remember how he suffered on your behalf, on my behalf. I want you to think of everything that you can contemplate about God, who loved you enough that he called you to himself, called you to be his sons and daughters, adopted you as his children, And I want you to place on that left-hand side everything that you can begin to imagine about God Himself. Now, when you get everything that you can comprehend, that you can conceive about God on the left-hand side, then on the right-hand side, what the apostle is saying now, you live your life in such a way that how you live on a daily basis balances out all the reality of who God is. Wow! You guess this is a pivot point in the book, huh? We're looking at God's redemption from heaven's perspective, and yet here God says to us, I want you to live on earth in such a way that your life balances out all that you have experienced of God. Do you understand? The more you and I see Jesus, the more our walk is balanced, worthy, as He is in the world. It never gets welded into place. It's not like you can put 1 pound on the left-hand side and then fill it with chocolate drops on the right-hand side until it balances out, and then just take a little tack of welder's process and weld it in place. And so I never have to worry about that again. I've got it fixed now. It's always going to be in balance. I can take out the chocolate drops and I can put in 16 bricks and it's still going to balance. No. Do you live in Texas? Do you live in the DFW area? Have you ever had your tires balanced? Why, there would be no reason ever to have them balanced a second time, right? Yeah, right. Just drive down Interstate 30 and hit the potholes that are in it right now, and you'll understand why it is that consistently we go back and have to get it in balance again. Our lives are lived in a daily scale of balancing the reality of who God is and how He wants us to live in a manner, walk worthy of who He is. I beseech you that you walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. Now we're going to talk in a moment about the only way we can accomplish that, but I want to tell you something. God is on a salvation march through the country of the dead and the damned, a broken culture. He is pointing them to who He is by the way you and I live on a daily basis. Our walk is what points people to the veracity of who He is. He is a living voice, and we give to Him a lived response. All right? Now that's the pivot. All that God is, looking at it from heaven's perspective, informs how we live on earth. Every bit of it informs how we live. Now you're thinking, Pastor, that's good for preachers because y'all don't know anything about temptation. Yeah, right. That's good for deacons because they never are tempted to sin. They're right. Listen, we put our shoes on just like you do. We experience the same temptation that you do. We are given to sin just as you are, except that something has happened not only in calling us, but in empowering us. Let's look at the power. The power. Do you remember how we read a few minutes ago that to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift? Therefore, it says, when He ascended on high, He led captive a host of captives, and He gave gifts to men. Now, what you and I need to understand is what He is doing is quoting from Psalm 68. And in that psalm, there is the story of the victor God who ascends and goes to the throne, but it doesn't say that He gave gifts in Psalm 68. In Psalm 68, it says that the king on the throne received gifts. Aha. Well, Paul's gotten kind of old and he can't remember exactly what the scripture says, right? Oh, no. Don't think that for a moment. He is reframing Psalm 68 for a contemporary application. He is reshaping Psalm 68 so that you and I understand what we have experienced in Jesus Christ. We were called into relationship with God. He chose us to be His sons and daughters. He paid the price for our redemption. He is inviting us to walk now in a manner that is worthy of the calling to which we have been called. And He said, furthermore, I will enable you to do it not in your own power, but I will pour out on you my Holy Spirit. Here's the story. Jesus was buried. Jesus was raised again. And then what happened next in Jesus' experience? He ascended to the right hand of the Father. And when He ascended, what happened? Just a short time later, the Spirit descended. From Bethany, Jesus went up to glory. From glory, the Spirit of God came down to Jerusalem. And the Spirit of God fell on those who are called into relationship with Jesus Christ. You and I need to understand, Romans 8:11 says, but if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who indwells you. He gave gifts to men. He gave the Holy Spirit to men. He distributed gifts to every member of the body of Christ for the building up of the body. You walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. Maturity in Christ is not a patchwork affair assembled out of bits and pieces of disciplines and devotions and doctrines and causes. It is the operation of God's triune Spirit in the practice of resurrection. God knows that apart from Him, we could not be saved, and apart from Him, we cannot be sanctified. And so He has resurrected the Lord Jesus, who has ascended, and sent the Spirit to indwell those of us that He has called, so that there is a new power for living, church. The power of the Spirit of God in you. There's one last thing I want us to see in this passage. For the building up of the body, the building up of the body itself in love. We've talked about the call, and we've talked about the walk, and we've talked about the pivot, and we've talked about the power. But we need to understand the place that this happens as well. All that we've talked about previously is very, very personal. It's God's call into your life, individually, you, right where you are. It's the Spirit of God coming to indwell you right where you are. But you need to understand, while it may be personal, it is also interpersonal. God was not just simply saving us so that we could be lone rangers standing all by ourselves. He was saving us. He was calling us. He was indwelling us so that He could bring us together in the eyes of the world to be one body, bonded together by one faith, one hope, one calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father who is over all, through all, and in all. It's all about Him, and it takes place in the context of His bride, the church. I hear people all the time talk about the fact that they really love Jesus, but they can't stand the church. Frankly, it doesn't matter whether you can stand it or not. If you're a child of God, you will be part of it. You are part of it. You don't get to pick and choose. It's not about some I like and some I don't like. That really doesn't have anything to do with it. Jesus said, when I call you to myself, I place you into my body, the church. I give gifts to bring that body to all it can be. Not because we like all those people, but because we are automatically a part of them. We're accepted together in the beloved, all of us with raw edges being conformed into the image of Jesus Christ. All a testimony together of the power of resurrection to make things new again. Jesus is breaking down every wall of separation, bringing all things together in Himself. Folks, we live in a sin-wrecked world. There are compound fractures everywhere you turn. You wouldn't know it, but the metaphor that Paul uses here for the body being fitted together is the same word that is used of an orthopedist who takes a compound fracture and knits it back together again. Sin has compound fractured everything in creation. And Jesus is putting it all back together again in the church. And that's who you are. That's who you're called to be. We live in a sin-wrecked world, compound fractures everywhere, that Jesus' Spirit is setting the broken bones as belief in His completed work is behaved in our daily lives. You and I are called into relationship. We're supposed to walk in a manner that balances out all the marvel of God in the miracle of the way we live. We can't do that on our own, so God said, I'll give you my Holy Spirit who will indwell you and empower you to live a daily life. But I don't do that so that you can do it all by yourself in some corner. I do it so that the world will see my bride, the church. And they'll look at her, and from the first century to the 21st century, they will see that she has problems. She's got some people who can't stand each other, but they get along anyway. She has some people who don't always agree with each other, but they get along anyway. She is not perfect, but she is being perfected. She is not finished yet. God isn't finished with her, but that's who you and I are, so that the world can watch the power of the Spirit of God that changes us into the very likeness of Jesus, so that a world can experience who He is. Father, thank you this morning that that's what you're doing. You're taking us, and not only have you called us into relationship, but you have said to us, those who are called must walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which we have been called. The scales balance. On the one hand, all that you are in your wonder, marvel, grace, love, mercy, balanced in the way that we live our lives living in a manner worthy of being recipients of that grace, love, mercy. Living in such a way that Jesus is reflected in our daily experience. Father, when we come later to look at these final three chapters of the book of Ephesians, we're going to see just how very practical you make this daily walk. For today, Father, we want to thank you that the pivot of this book and the pivot of our lives is the balancing of the great grace that we have received and the walk that we give in our daily lives to you. Thank you, Father, that you haven't left it to our own power to accomplish that, but rather that the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead now dwells in us, that the one who ascended also descended and came to us and gave gifts so that the body could be built up together in Christ to all the fullness of Jesus. I want to thank you for those who are here this morning, those who are online with us today, Father. Because I understand that Grandview couldn't be the body of Jesus without each one of them, that which every single member supplies. I thank you for those who are on our safety team, those who are on our properties team, those who are on our stewardship team, those who are on our staff team. I thank you for those who are on our personnel team. I thank you for those who are teachers. I thank you for those who work with our children, our preschoolers. I understand, Father, this morning, in some way, that if any of us are not a part, then the body is not complete. So, Father, this morning we value the church. And we thank you that that church is the object of your divine love. And it is your church to walk in the midst of a world that doesn't know you, showing the grace and mercy of lives changed by Jesus. Father, we conclude this morning by saying to you, if our own lives are not measuring up to the marvelous grace that we have received, then we ask you, Spirit of God, to purge us, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Take away, Father, our desire for things that don't honor and glorify you. Oh, Father, we pray that you will stir in our hearts a longing to bring honor to Jesus, to live lives worthy of the calling that we have received. We thank you that it's not in our power, but it is totally within your power, Spirit, to accomplish that in us. Speak, direct, and we will respond. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. In just a minute, we're going to sing. When we sing, it's really a moment for you to listen to the Spirit of God and to respond to what He's calling in your life. It may be that you're here this morning, here online, and you've never trusted Christ as Savior. We would not want you to go through one more hour without having responded to the call of God in your life, to know Him. Maybe you're here this morning and you do know Him, but you've looked at the scales and you've realized that the walk doesn't measure up with the grace that you've received, the calling. And you'd simply come back to God this morning and say, Spirit of God, do a fresh work in me. God, I can't do it, but you can. And so I relinquish the control of my life again into the hands of the Spirit of God. Spirit of God, live in me. Glorify yourself in me. Let others look at me and see Jesus. Maybe that's the prayer you need to pray as we sing this song. As God speaks, let Him do what He needs to do right now in you. Let's sing together.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Though what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior.
Could you do just the chorus one more time? Just as you sing this word about praising Him all day long, understand that's the walk. That's the daily walk. That's measuring up to the wonder of who God is. Let's sing just the chorus again. Here it is.
This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior. Do
the tag one more time.
Praising my Savior all the day long.
It is so important that the church be the church. Part of our opportunity and relationship with Jesus Christ is bringing our offerings, our tithes, and giving as an expression of our gratitude to the marvel of the grace that has been lavished upon us. Next week, we're going to look at rocket verbs, seven of them, one after another, that shoot up to heaven and show us the way that God has called us into relationship with Him, the way He's lavished His love upon us, the way that He has marvelously bestowed upon us amazing love and amazing grace. The more that we look at Him, the more it's going to direct the way that we live on a daily basis, praising my Savior all the day long. As you prepare your tithes and your offerings and you leave this morning, you may place those on the offering plate as you leave. Our deacon this week is Eddie Mick. Eddie is not with us this morning. I invite you just to bow your hearts together with us as we spend just a brief 30 seconds in your own silent prayer. And then we will amen together. In Jesus' name, amen. Go and live for Him. God bless you and good day.